lead clean lives and stick to low fat or what have you, that then perhaps learn what some of those issues of temperance might be from the evidence that Dr. Marc Blackman might give us. Dr. Blackman is here from the National Institutes of Health, where he is the clinical director and the chief of the laboratory of clinical investigation in the newly designated National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine, where he's been for the past 17 months or so. Before that, and still, I believe, he has been professor of medicine and endocrinology at Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine in Baltimore, where he and his colleagues have done extremely important work over the years on aging and gonadal function, aging and the growth hormone axis, hormone replacement therapy in aging, and we've seen very important studies come from his group that have altered our way of thinking about hormonal therapy in aging. And Marc is an old and dear friend. Our paths have crossed many times. And this is his second aging conference visit to San Antonio in about 5 years. And we welcome him back and look forward to his talk on complementary medicine in prostate cancer and prevention. Dr. Blackman.
Thank you, Michael. It's really a delight to be back. I am going to talk about something a little bit different, but I'm going to take an approach that I think will be recognizable to all of you, I hope. And I'd like to begin by giving you an outline of what I'd like to say in the next 40 or 45 minutes and leave some time for questions and answers. I'd like to divide this talk into a few segments. I'm going to say a few things about aging that you probably all know already. I'm going to talk a little bit about how we in the National Center of Complementary and Alternative Medicine envision CAM, or Complementary and Alternative Medicine, and give you our construct as we think about it and see if we share that, which I hope we do. And then I will attend to some of the issues related to prostate cancer, and there have been so many marvelous discussions before, including this wonderful session just prior, that I'll be able to bypass a lot of the biology elements to get to a few of the things that I think are on people's minds in the CAM arena. So it's rather obvious to all of us that in this last millennium, longevity has been increasing steadily. As a consequence of that steady increase in longevity, the number of people who are designated as old, arbitrarily defined as over the age of 65, and geriatricians don't talk about just old, they talk about young old and old old. The young old, euphemistically speaking, are 65 to 84.9, and the old, and you know who you are, and the old old are 85 and above. Now, as it happens, in the next three decades, the number of people in the young old category is going to increase by 2 to 3-fold. The sex predilection and longevity of women is narrowing, as it turns out, in this country, as in other Western countries where demographic and epidemiological data have been collected. And the number of old old, that is over the age of 85, is the most rapidly growing age demographic group in this country and several other Western industrialized nations in which such data have been collected. So we are upon us a geriatric wave. Now, for those of you who, like myself, enjoy art, you'll all recognize these as two Rembrandt self-portraits. He painted many self-portraits. And I often think that he painted many self-portraits, being just a physician, because he applied for a grant for a model and it was approved and not funded. So on the left is young Rembrandt at age 19, looking youthful and robust. On the right is this same Mr. Rembrandt at age 62, looking less than well. And it's our desire in this room and our medical establishment internationally to have both for men and for women a kinder and gentler shift from one to the other. So what, in fact, do we mean by complementary and alternative medicine, which I'll refer to hereafter as CAM? We define it as medical and healthcare practices outside the realm of conventional medicine, which are yet to be validated using scientific methods. And you'll notice there's a complementary element and an alternative element. Complementary means that whatever the modality might be, it's taken in conjunction with conventional practices. In fact, all the surveys nationally and internationally show that 80 to 85% of usage of CAM modalities is complementary to, rather than alternative to, mainstream treatment. By definition, alternative is in place of conventional practices. And only the minority of people in Western countries, we don't have good data from the Eastern world on this, but certainly in industrialized Western nations, that's the case. Now, we in NCAM, National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine, conceptualize the panoply of modalities in CAM in five broad categories, as you can see. Biologically based systems, which are the most familiar to all of us who are mainstream types, namely herbs, botanicals, and dietary supplements. More about those momentarily. Body manipulative and body based systems, such as chiropractic or therapeutic massage, in contrast to just a back rub. Mind-body medicine, which often abuts upon serious neuroscience and neurobiology in today's world, including yoga, prayer, meditation, and the biology of the placebo effect, an area of intense interest these days to clinicians, scientists, patients, and the world, and of course to us by definition. Alternative medical systems, of which there are many, including but not limited to homeopathy, naturopathy, Indian Ayurvedic medicine, traditional Chinese medicine, TCM, and so forth. And energy-based therapies of a variety of kinds, including magnet therapy, for example, for sciatica, where there is actually a sound basis for that, to other forms of, say, distant touch or that sort of thing, such as Reiki and Qigong. Now, there have been many surveys, but the most robust, many of you who've read any of this literature have read the Eisenberg surveys in JAMA, which have been done sequentially, showing increased usage of many modalities, and we'll talk about those momentarily. But those wonderful surveys, and David and his colleagues up at the Beth Israel in Boston have done wonderful surveys, but they're only of a few thousand people. However, the most robust in the United States was just published a few years ago from a National Health Survey in 30,000, nearly 31,000 adults. And in that last year prior to that, and this is the most recent survey, the most recent published Eisenberg survey was in 97, the earlier one was in 1990, both in JAMA. In this most recent survey, in the year before, 29% of adults in this nation surveyed of that number used one or another CAM therapy. Interestingly, women and college graduates were the most prevalent users. And among the most commonly used therapies are herbal, chiropractic, and massage, as you can see. From this same database, you just confirm a wide array. Again, herbal and dietary supplements are in here. And actually, the lead one is spiritual healing and prayer, in fact, widely used by people for diverse reasons. Now, before the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine, there had been a several-year history of its predecessor, the Office of Alternative Medicine. But in essence, in 1998, the Congress legislated this as a national center, as they have several other centers at the NIH. The general purposes of NCAM are the conduct and support of basic and applied research, research training, and other programs with respect to identifying, investigating, and validating CAM treatments, diagnostic and prevention modalities, disciplines and systems, public law, as you can see. What is our mission as we translate it to plain language? It's to conduct rigorous research on CAM practices, to educate and train CAM researchers, both those from mainstream and those from non-mainstream backgrounds, and most importantly, to inform our population, consumers and health professionals, in separating the wheat from the chaff. So it's intuitively obvious to a group such as this that we face many unusual challenges in this daunting, but exciting, and health-provocative endeavor. And they include the broad spectrum of CAM practices, which is bewildering. The products are already in widespread use, and they are self-prescribed, remember. There is a tremendous inconsistency with product and practice standards. Practice, such as acupuncture, products such as biologic, complex botanicals. There is a tremendous dearth of virtual absence of a credible scientific database, despite large amounts of anecdotal data. There are many market disincentives, think dietary supplements, to further research. Few CAM practitioners are really experienced in clinical, laboratory, or translational investigation. And I must say, in my own experience personally in 25 years in medicine, this has the most diverse community of stakeholders imaginable. So because a lot of the data are anecdotal, I'd reframe this into a more pithy remark. The plural of anecdote, in my humble estimation, is not the same thing as evidence. So to kind of counter that from a phase three perspective, forgetting all the details of what led to that, we now have at NCAM in the extramural portfolio a number of phase three clinical trials going on, either alone or in partnership with other institutes listed on the right side of the slide. Today's topic, of course, is prostate cancer, so I am going to talk a little bit later about the SELECT trial, primarily driven by NCI, but in which NCAM is an important partner. Most CAM treatments in oncology, as in non-oncology, are not practiced, as you would imagine, in an academic or research setting. Most of them are unknown to experienced investigators. In the context of oncology, which is today's topic, they are generally marginalized by mainstream oncologists. And in fact, many of these treatments are proprietary or delivered outside of regulatory scrutiny, and more about that in a moment. And there is a history of mistrust, and as a classically trained person earlier in my life, there is a difference, we all know, between cynicism, a la Diogenes in the ancient world, and healthy skepticism. And all of us are trained to be laser-like skeptics and should be. Cynicism, I would posit, is a little less healthy. There's a history of mistrust between CAM practitioners and federal agencies in general. Now, my colleague in NCAM, Marianne Richardson, who's an oncologist, published this particular review of CAM use by adult cancer patients in the Journal of Clinical Oncology, JCO, just recently, as you can see. And as is evident from this particular survey, it mirrors CAM use in general. And I should say what probably everybody here also knows, and that is that in the nation at large and in all industrialized societies where we have data, and we have it from many industrialized societies, including Japan and a variety of other European, South American, and other industrialized nations. Cancer is the commonest condition for which people use CAM modalities, far and away. Numbers 2 and 3 on the list are musculoskeletal disorders and neurobehavioral, psychobehavioral disorders, and then the long litany of everything else in medicine. And of course, you would immediately recognize as oncology-oriented people that cancer musculoskeletal and neurobehavioral often coexist in the same person. So as I said, CAM use in general is higher in women than in men, interestingly among better educated rather than less well educated individuals. All the surveys confirm this. Particularly high among those who receive chemotherapy in a variety of approaches, as you can see, as listed on this slide, or used widely, and you've seen that on the recent slides. So some of the obstacles to studies of complementary and alternative medicine, beyond what I've already said is our daunting challenges a few slides ago, relate to what was commented upon in the prior session. Firmly held beliefs, and you know, perhaps another way of phrasing it from our perspective as science-driven people is, in God we trust, everyone else shows data. Nonetheless, here, the obverse is often the case. A lack of preclinical data or defined mechanisms, unstandardized or impure products, complex modalities, for example, system approaches like traditional Chinese medicine, where multiple things are going on, each of which is itself intrinsically complex. How to sort that out in an experimental algorithm is going to take some novel and creative clinical investigative design skills. And of course, the ethics of withholding standard care enter into all of this. Now, as it happens, the NCI, the National Cancer Institute, has a long-standing interest in cancer CAM that predated the arrival of NCAM. And they've developed in recent years something they call the best case series, which is really what you'd call a sophisticated anecdote. It's an NCI-designed instrument to identify promising CAM treatments through a retrospective review of a small number of cases. The practitioner selects cases for review. The diagnosis and outcome are well documented. The CAM treatment is well described. There are no or identifiable confounding factors, and the survival time is unexpectedly long. And in this best case series, which has now been done for several CAM modalities, hints, which is all there can be, hints of where to look investigationally have arisen. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that among the biological elements are herbs, botanicals, and dietary supplements. So I have to mention what, again, probably everybody here knows. The 1994 Legislated Deshaies Act, as we call it, the Dietary Supplement Health and Education Act, was a seminal event if you happen to have stock in a dietary supplement company. Because what it did was, number one, define a dietary supplement as a product intended to supplement the diet which contains one or more of the following: a vitamin, a mineral, an herb or other botanical, excluding tobacco, an amino acid, and then, broadly speaking, any other dietary supplement. Well, that covers a lot of terrain. For oral intake as a concentrate, metabolite, extract, constituent, or combination. I don't see phlogiston on the list, but I suppose perhaps that might do it. Now, one of the important elements of this Deshaies Act is that the FDA, that all that needs to be proved is that there is no harm, not that there is efficacy. Moreover, the FDA has no regulatory oversight over dietary supplements, minimal. It's, of all things, in the Department of Justice. So it's important for you to recognize that dietary supplements, as defined here by our legislation in 1994, national legislation in this country, defined as you're looking at it, that's what a dietary supplement is. And among the range of entrepreneurial stakeholders, as you might imagine, might be those who have an interest in entrepreneurially in these substances. So another way that I think about it, a little bit differently from this, is because I like to go back to what wiser people said, is sort of this way. People can be induced to swallow anything, provided it is sufficiently seasoned with praise, said one Jean Molière. And I think it's important to keep that in mind. Now, to get from the CAM motif to the subject of today with that little background, I'm not going to talk a lot about incidence and prevalence because you've heard it so well described in the prior sessions, except for the obvious fact that the incidence of the five most common cancers in men, at least from the 70s to in the decade of the 70s and 80s, and forgive me for having older data here, but you've seen better data in the recent talks. You can see where prostate stands. You can see what we all know, that African American men have a higher frequency and also changing rates as compared with Caucasian men. And as was so nicely stated by Dr. Brawley in the previous talk, there has been a systematic approximately 20% error in this. So I'm not going to give you exact numbers because these slides, of course, are inaccurate, because they're overestimates, as was just stated. And the death rates from the six most common cancers in men in the several decades that you're looking at are substantial and generally flat for most, but of course increasing dramatically for lung and bronchoalveolar, particularly because of smoking, of course, but for other reasons, I'm sure. And you'll notice that GI cancer, specifically stomach cancer, has decreased, as has been widely publicized. But prostate cancer has been, at least in that decade by this particular epidemiological analysis, relatively flat. And you've seen a slide like this before, and you're well accustomed already to thinking of the age-associated increase in prostate cancer. Now, what I'd like to turn to is several segments of the remainder of this discussion. In this particular component, I'd like to talk a little bit about some hormonology with regard to androgens and the insulin-like growth factor 1 axis, which is an important but by no means the sole growth factor player interprostatically and possibly, ? systemically. So my colleague, Mitch Harmon, and I, and several others, when we were all together in Baltimore at the Aging Institute, did a study, which I'll show you some clips of momentarily. But testosterone and DHT, dihydrotestosterone, are primarily in the elaborated by the epithelial elements, which contain androgen receptors, which contain 5-alpha reductase, and are, by definition, androgen responsive. Estrogen receptors, like ER-alpha, are in the interstitial elements and respond to estrogens, whether they be mainstream pharmacologic estrogens or phytoestrogens or natural estrogenic products. Insulin-like growth factors, the whole family of them, includes insulin-like growth factor 1, or IGF-1, the main but not sole modulator of growth hormone's actions. And such type 1 receptors and its message have been found in prostate tissue in stimulating growth hormone, in stimulating prostate cell growth in vitro. Importantly, IGF-2, in contrast, is decreased both intraprostatically and in the blood of patients with prostate CA. It is inversely related to prostate cancer, and you'll see more about that in a moment. And there are several, actually 6, IGF binding proteins, and most of them are found in prostate tissue and contribute to the internal regulation and are hormonally responsive to a variety of hormonal inputs, growth hormone, androgens, estrogens, to name some that are really important here in carcinogenesis. And PSA, of course, you know all about. Now, again, my colleagues and I in Baltimore had the advantage to look at a large number of healthy men in the Baltimore Longitudinal Study on Aging, BLSA, which we published a couple of years ago in the Journal of Clinical Endocrinology and Metabolism. And we looked both cross-sectionally and, I think uniquely, longitudinally over 30 to 35 years. This is a cross-sectional survey, but I can assure you that longitudinally there's a progressive, inexorable decline both in testosterone, as shown in the left panel, and in the free testosterone, disproportionately so, as shown in the right. And concurrently, there's an age-related decrease in the growth hormone IGF-1 axis, as measured in this particular instance by IGF-1 levels in the blood. And we think that those declines with aging in men of the testosterone axis and the growth hormone axis are interrelated. And in fact, we've done a lot of work to support that, and I won't get into that at the moment. Now, many of you read a paper that created quite a stir in science in 1998 from Dr. Chan and his colleagues at Harvard, in which he labeled circulating IGF-1 essentially as a marker for prostate cancer based upon a case-control study, as you see outlined here, that he actually claimed, which is quite extraordinary, I think, to any prostate-oriented biologist or epidemiologist, to be a more potent risk factor in statistical terms than PSA, which is hard to imagine. It was so hard to imagine that that's what led my colleagues and I to try to confirm and extend that. Now, this cartoon simply shows that the IGF-1 system in the prostate has actions both at the epithelial cell, which is sort of the hormonal androgen side, and the stromal cell, which, as I've said a moment ago, is sort of the estrogenic side. And it's very complex, and this cartoon doesn't do it justice. So we did a case-control study, which we also published a couple of years ago in the Journal of Clinical Endocrinology and Metabolism, which was also a case-control study with cases, controls, and normals. And we also looked at prostate, in addition to looking at a variety of hormones, as shown on the next slide, we also looked at prostate size by MRI of the prostate, which is a very sensitive measurement. And we measured in the blood, using very contemporary assays, IGF-1, IGF-2, IGF binding protein 3, the principal binding protein for growth hormone in the blood, PSA, testosterone and SHBG, and calculated a free testosterone, and as I just said, MRI size of the prostate. And I don't have time to show you the data, so I will summarize what we found and reported. Where we both confirmed and extended and in some regards refuted the Chan paper. And what we found was that IGF-1, IGF-2, and PSA, but not IGF binding protein 3, BP, or free testosterone index, a free testosterone, are significant risk factors for prostate CA. And that PSA, as you would intuitively imagine, is the strongest predictor of cancer risk. That a low IGF-2 is a moderately strong risk factor. As I said before, there's an inverse relationship. That high IGF-1 is a relatively weak risk factor, but low IGF-1 may be protective. And we found a less strong effect in our analysis than did Dr. Chan in a somewhat similar number of men. In estimates of predictive power, specificity, and sensitivity, which you're all used to thinking about, revealed that PSA is a moderately good screening test, and I'm going to put all of that issue aside, having just listened to a wonderful discussion. But IGF-1, and we'll say screening in the abstract, but IGF-1 or IGF-2 alone are not. And prediction is improved slightly by addition of an IGF-2, but not of an IGF-1 criterion to the PSA. Moreover, PSA is a very strong correlate of prostate size, and my Hopkins prostate colleagues, Dr. Walsh and Dr. Bell Carter and those folks, assure me that one of the major risk factors for prostate cancer is prostate size. That IGF-2 is a moderately strong inverse correlate of prostate size, as assessed by MRI, which is a pretty good measure, non-invasively speaking. That IGF-1, IGF-BP3, and free thyroxine index, free testosterone index, are not significantly associated with prostate size. So we concluded from this particular purview that the non-significantly higher IGF-1 in cases and lack of association of IGF-1 with increased prostate size suggested that endogenous circulating IGF-1 does not contribute importantly in adults to prostate proliferation or prostate cancer, that low levels of IGF-1 are associated with lower cancer risk. Remember, we're talking about in the circulation, not in the autocrine-paracrine system within the prostate. That higher serum IGF-2 concentrations may protect against prostate cell proliferation, thereby reducing prostate cancer risk, and that a knowledge of serum IGFs and their binding proteins actually add very little diagnostic utility for prostate cancer when you know PSA, and we'll remember the symposium that just occurred prior to this. In other words, they're not that helpful. So now let's turn from that, because you might say, well, why is he talking about IGF-1 and all that growth factor? Because many of these biologics that we're going to get to work through hormonally active mechanisms in, we believe, in epithelial or stromal cells. And in a punchline, which I'll mention at the very end, we're actually examining in the laboratory using molecular, cellular, and biochemical techniques now prostate cells derived from men with cancer of androgen AR positive and negative types to address some of these issues in the laboratory. But in any event, PC SPES, more in a moment about that, has been incredibly highlighted in this nation and a number of other countries as a potentially useful adjunct to the management of men with advanced prostate cancer. And I will discuss that more in the next several slides. Independently of that, there is a panoply of unproven but widely used CAM modalities in the context of caring for the side effects subsequent to gonadosteroid deprivation from gonadotropin agonists. Now, everyone who knows endocrinology knows that gonadosteroid deprivation in a man has protean manifestations, not just psychosexual disruption, but leads to general disruptions such as an increase in fatigue, cardiovascular abnormalities, including dyslipidemia, vasomotor flushing and thermoregulatory dysfunction, as in a perimenopausal or early postmenopausal women, anemia, decreased muscle mass and strength and performance, what we call sarcopenia, increased fat mass disproportionately in the belly with glucose and insulin abnormalities and dyslipidemia and the metabolic X syndrome, and of course psychosexual dysfunction. And without my giving you a laundry list, because they're largely unproved, although widely used, remember Jean Molière's comment. Think of that and what we need to do. So let's talk about PC-SPES. PC-SPES is a complex Chinese-derived botanical containing 8 different dietary supplements, which include chrysanthemum, licorice, ginseng, salt, palmetto, scutellaria, and 3 others. It has been used widely. In fact, there are now, I can tell you for a fact, there are now in the United States, there's a whole society related to this that's very serious, actually, and academically oriented, where there are probably somewhere between 30 and 40,000 men in this country alone, and many more in other countries, who are using this product in the belief that it's going to help them. And it comes primarily from the bottom 2 bullets. Several small phase 1 and specifically 2 studies which suggest safety, improved quality of life, reduction of pains, including bone pain, and substantial, often remarkably impressive, reductions in serum PSA levels, including this particular study by Pfeiffer et al. As well as, unfortunately, a series of anti-androgenic or pro-estrogenic estrogenic side effects, including loss of libido, breast tenderness, lower PSA levels, as shown in a New England Journal paper by DiPaolo and colleagues. There have been several attempts to apply gene array analysis to isolated prostate cells. And for those of you who are prostate biology oriented, you'll know that LNCaP cells are a standard cell line derived from androgen receptor positive prostate cancer patient. And without going through all the gory details, the important point is there are now several papers in the literature, including one by Nelson in 2001. That show estrogenic-like effects in terms of turn-on of genes on microarray analysis in vitro when you expose such androgen-responsive cells, which are actually, in this case, epithelial and not stromal cells. So all that sounds pretty good until I send up this slide, because many of you, especially those of you who are urology-focused, probably know that in the last 6 to 8 months, PC-SPES has been highlighted all over the place as not being what it was cracked up to be. which gets back to one of our daunting challenges that I mentioned earlier. And why is that? On February 8th, the California Department of Health, which is where the only company that made past tense, PC Spes, Botanic Lab, found that in their extensive survey of adulterants and contaminants, there were several major contaminants that can't be contaminants, but rather had to be adulterants. And of course, the difference is quite considerable, you might imagine. And those included warfarin, indomethacin, and hold your seats, diethyl stilbestrol. So that created a problem. The product was recalled. On June 1st, Botanic Lab announced that it ceased operations. The product is no longer available in this country. On June 21st, NCCAM suspended the research studies that it was sponsoring in its extramural portfolio, including a very large study at Johns Hopkins in collaboratively in Singapore and Johns Hopkins in two different populations of men, African American and Singapore-based residents. And the an ad hoc gold standard group was convened, which agreed with all of this and recommended this, and our National Advisory Council as well. So clinical studies now don't take place in the United States for the moment because of this concern. But preclinical studies in the laboratory with products whose composition is identified are being looked at extensively. I'm going to switch from PC Spes. You might say to me, as our council members said to us recently, what's going to happen to these 30 or 40,000 men who believe in their hearts and minds that they are benefiting from the adjunctive use of this product? And I won't get into that issue at the moment, although we are addressing that in a multi-institute and extremely diligent manner. But you can see the nature of the problem. It was said before by a panelist how important it is in the large scale of making decisions. This would be a scale 3 decision by my Hopkins colleagues, decision-making scale. It's not a personal decision. It's not an individual medical decision. These are societal decisions, and this one was a bad one. So let's turn to two dietary supplements that are very much in the news and part of the biggest ever preventative trial that the National Cancer Institute has done for chemo prevention of cancer. So let's talk for a moment about selenium and vitamin E. Selenium is a non-metallic trace element. It's an essential nutrient and constituent of many important enzyme systems. And the typical dietary intake of most adults in this country is 80 to 120 milligrams per day, and the RDA, that should read micrograms per day, excuse me, and the RDA is 0.87 microgram per kilogram. Importantly, in more than 100 laboratory-based studies in diverse model systems, it has been shown to have numerous anti-tumorigenic effects, most impressively as an antioxidant, and the others listed, which I won't read for the sake of time. Vitamin E, otherwise referred to us as alpha-tocopherol, is really vitamin E, a family of naturally occurring essential fat-soluble vitamin compounds. It is the major lipid-soluble antioxidant in cell membranes, and alpha-tocopherol is incredibly widely distributed in nature, and importantly, is the predominant form that occurs in humans. It too has been shown in a large array of laboratory-based studies to have a multiplicity of anti-tumorigenic effects, the most important of which is that it's a vicious antioxidant, particularly against DNA damage induced by carcinogenic agents, and then the long laundry list of other adverse effects that it has that would be considered to be mechanistically what we'd want it to have. But let's translate that now to some human studies, which are really more telling, perhaps. So selenium, as many here know, has been studied and reported in two really important, albeit less than well-controlled, studies, the nutrition intervention trials 1 and 2 from China. In the first one, study number one, 29,000 men, 40 to 70 years of age, were given selenium, vitamin E, and beta carotene in the doses shown. And they were shown subsequently, again, this is not well controlled, but the data were impressive and were published in the JNCI, both these papers. Decrease in all-cause cancer mortality of 13% and in stomach cancer mortality of 21%. Prostate cancer was not particularly studied in that particular report. Intervention study 2 from the same province in China assessed 3,000 patients, men and women, with esophageal dysplasia who received selenium and beta carotene in the doses shown daily and also showed a decrease in total cancer mortality and in gastric mortality. But what really set a lot of people afire in the NCI was number 3. Again, not really targeted to the prostate, but it led to some important studies. 1,312 patients reported by Clark et al. And JAMA in 1996 who had skin cancer and were randomized to receive 200, that should read microgram, per day of selenium versus placebo for an average of 4.5 years. And there were enough incident prostate cancers that it was shown fairly clearly, statistically, that there was a 2/3 reduction in incident prostate cancer by the particular definitions used, and we won't get into that complexity here, in the people who took selenium. A little bit about alpha-tocopherol. The most important study that all of you have heard about and read about, I'm sure, is the alpha-tocopherol beta-carotene cancer prevention trial from Finland, the so-called ATBC study, published several years ago. In that study, 29,000 men who were smokers, 50 to 69 years old, were given racemic, that is DL, alpha-tocopherol, and or beta-carotene, all these milligrams should be micrograms, excuse me, daily, with a mean follow-up of 6.1 years. And impressively, incident prostate cancer decreased by 32%. And although they were relatively small numbers, they were still statistically meaningful, there was a decrease in prostate cancer-related mortality that was even greater, 41%. Now these preclinical data, epidemiological data, and controlled and non-controlled interventional data with selenium and with alpha-tocopherol slash vitamin E stimulated the National Cancer Institute to create the SELECT trial, or the Selenium Vitamin E Prostate Prevention Multicenter trial, which actually has its home base right here in this very city. The Southwest Oncology Group and the group right here at UT San Antonio is one of the seminal groups in this important study. It is primarily paid for, of course, by NCI, but there is an important contribution from NCAM, and it's a true partnership because, of course, this fits our mandate, as you might imagine from what I said in the beginning. So let's talk about this trial a little bit. The most recent data could be argued about depending on whose numbers you read, but in Caucasians versus African Americans, the lifetime risk of developing prostate cancer, and of course it depends how you define it, and I won't get into all those nuances, is approximately 16.5% in Caucasian men, and higher, as you know, but only somewhat higher, and as Dr. Brawley said, not disproportionately higher, just somewhat higher in African American men. So too for prostate cancer-related death rates, same phenomenon. There had been an overstatement that's been emphasized. Until SELECT, the largest extant, still ongoing, chemo prevention trial for prostate cancer is the prostate cancer prevention trial, the PCPT, which as you can see is winding down. Began in 1993, it's a 10-year study, it ends in 2003, almost over. An RCT, a randomized controlled double-blind study, in 18,000 men, to determine the efficacy of finasteride, a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, to inhibit androgenic input into the prostate in a controlled fashion, in reducing incident prostate cancer. Now, as I've already said, preclinical and epidemiological studies, controlled and uncontrolled trials, suggest that selenium and an alpha tocopherol, vitamin E, might do the same. So SELECT, and I'll describe it just briefly in the next slide, is actually the second large-scale study and is actually the largest ever study of chemo prevention, in this country at least, for prostate cancer. It too, not surprisingly, is an RCT, randomized controlled double-blind study, which began last year, 2001, can extend as long as 12 years, but there are certain benchmark criteria by which it may end after 7 years, in 32,400 healthy men divided into four groups to determine the efficacy of selenium alone, vitamin E alone, the two together in a 2x2 factorial design manner for preventing prostate cancer. So the objectives, in large part, primary aim of this study is to prevent prostate cancer, and thus incident prostate cancer is the primary endpoint, as defined by DRE, digital rectal exam, and PSA, and not by other more elegant diagnostic tests. There's a multiplicity, as you'd imagine, of secondary outcome measures, including overall survival, cancer-free survival, cardiovascular, quality of life, and so forth. The doses that are used are, as shown, selenium 200 micrograms orally daily, vitamin E 400 milligrams per day orally daily, separately or together in a 2x2 factorial design. Men have to be 55 or older if they're Caucasian, or 50 years of age or older if they happen to be African American. And they must have no prior history of prostate CA. And the follow-up period at 6-month intervals with annual DREs and PSAs is a minimum of 7 years and a maximum of 12 years, with the details that I'll leave out for the purpose of this. I want to close on a different axis, because we talked about androgens, we talked about testosterone and dihydrotestosterone. But another one out there that is a dietary supplement that I worry about as just your local physician from the Baltimore, Washington area, I worry about it a lot, is DHEA. Why do I worry about it? Well, let's talk about it for a moment. DHEA is a weak adrenal androgen. It is the most abundant steroids in humans. Its levels decrease beginning in the 20s and proceed inexorably, so that by the time men and women, in this case men, are in their 80s, the levels are reduced by about 80%. And many have posited, and we are systematically actually among those who are trying to assess, whether these age-related declines in DHEA contribute to such concomitants of the aging process as that familiar litany of sarcopenia, osteopenia, metabolic X syndrome, immune dysfunction, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Trust me, there are insufficient data to say whether that's the case in humans, although in animal models, it's unequivocally shown that giving DHEA in suprapharmacologic doses that bear no relation to the rat, and the rat physiology bears zero relation to humans, does something good in retarding the aging process. It extends longevity, it improves muscle strength, improves bone strength, improves immune function, retards cancer development, even to provocation by a carcinogenic stimulus, and does all these things in rodents. The problem is DHEA physiology in rodents bears no relation to that in humans. More importantly, from a public health perspective, literally millions of men and women are self-prescribing DHEA itself of uncharacterized quality. So if you go into your local GNC store, as has been done and reported in the endocrine literature, and you take 50 bottles of DHEA from the same and different manufacturers and you put them on HPLC, GC mass spec, etc., you'll get from 0% to 100% with a mean that'll vary depending on the vagaries of the dew point. But independent of that is the fact that the efficacy has not been established in humans, and for this discussion, I want to talk about the safety has not been established. Why is that? Because DHEA, we now know endocrinologically, not only can be converted to androgens and act like an androgen through the androgen receptor or its isomorphs, it can be converted to an estrogen and act through estrogen receptor alpha or beta or their isomorphs. It can work through GABAergic receptors. It can work through non-genomic means. And there's also a recently touted new receptor that may or may not be pertinent. So DHEA can do a lot of things. In the context of its acting like an androgen, potentially, just imagine large numbers of men who either have prostate cancer, perhaps even in an advanced form, who take DHEA because of its purported anti-aging and mood elevating effects. I say purported in triple quotation marks, where one might imagine, and this is still hypothetical, acting as an androgen, it could do something bad. Conversely, acting as an estrogen, it might do something good. Conversely, acting as an androgen and estrogen, goodness knows, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we are collaborating with a number of folks in the NCI and have set up a laboratory project, as I mentioned at the beginning. And we've already shown in some preliminary studies and just presented it at an NIH symposium a month ago that DHEA actually behaves very much in LINCAP cells, those androgen receptor positive prostate cancer cells, like testosterone and DHT in vitro, which we've examined. It binds to the androgen receptor. It reduces IGF binding protein 2. It turns on PSA with abandon. Not good. So we're concerned about this, and we're also concerned with how to address this, not only in the laboratory, which is much more straightforward, but in a clinically relevant fashion, because we're concerned about a theoretic possibility. We are equally concerned, I might say, about its possible adverse consequence to the breast in women who have breast cancer and are about to launch an initiative in that same way. So we quoted Santayana once. We'll quote him again. Skepticism, I would say, or better yet, Santayana would say, is the chastity of the intellect. That's a nice phrase. And it's shameful to surrender it too soon or to the first comer. So I think another way of thinking about that in a more prosaic fashion, if you happen to be a little blue and are deciding that you want to take some St. John's wort and you don't know exactly yet what it does, is to perhaps look in the mirror. Thank you.